Hello and welcome to this month's edition of Food and Farms Berks County Style. I'm Sheila Miller, Berks County's Agricultural Coordinator, and this month we're going to be talking about the Penn Street Market as well as showing you a video that was produced by the Berks Career and Technology Students West Campus. I wanted to start off by talking about the Penn Street Market, which is an outdoor market that we have had since 2009 here in the city of Reading. We are currently located in the 800 block of the city of Reading, and as I said, we are outdoors, so we are on a beautifully bricked plaza just next to the health clinic in the city of Reading, and again, shade trees and beautiful breezes blow throughout the market, and it's a great place to come every Friday from now until October 4th, which is our final Penn Street Market for the season. We are open from 10:30 to 2:30 every Friday, and sometimes my vendors get there a little earlier than 10:30, so if you're an early bird and want to try, you can certainly walk to the market or drive to the market anytime after 9 o'clock. Sometimes my vendors are setting up, and sometimes they stay a little bit later than 2:30 as well. If you are interested in driving to the market, there's free parking in the 9th and Cherry Street lot, and that is every Friday from now until October 4th. For more information and a complete schedule about the Penn Street Market, if you are computer savvy, you can go to our website, which is www.pennstreetmarket.org, or call my office at 610-898-5482. This year we have some returning vendors at the Penn Street Market. Glenn Hoover, who joined us last year, is a Lancaster County farmer in neighboring Reinholds, and he comes to us with wonderful fruits and vegetables. He also brings brown eggs by the dozen, and we're glad to have Glenn Hoover coming back and joining us at Penn Street Market. Last week, our opening Friday was a little bit rainy, but Glenn brought to the market onions, tomatoes, strawberries, sugar peas, and lettuce. And as we go throughout the season, he'll be bringing whatever he's growing at that time of the market season. Right now, we start off with strawberries, but in October, we'll have pumpkins and zucchini squash and things that are typically your fall produce. So again, Penn Street Market is open, and we are excited to have not just Glenn Hoover coming back, but also Jim Griesmer, who is a beekeeper. He will be joining us once he gets back from his honeymoon, and he'll be with us in July. And this year, we have a new baker at the Penn Street Market, and her name is Pamela Rojas. And Pamela comes to us from the West Reading area, and this is her very first year at Penn Street Market. And I can tell you, having sampled some of her delicious cupcakes from the Penn Street Market last week when I purchased them, I am just tickled to death to have her with us at Penn Street Market. So Pamela, welcome.
Thank you.
It's great to have you be part of the Penn Street Market, and great to have you as part of Food and Farms Berks County Style for this month. And what I thought we would do is talk a little bit about your business that you're launching, and how you came up with the name, and just tell us a little bit more about your business.
It's Pamela's Delectables. I make cakes and cupcakes right now. We're branching out. Maybe there's going to be some brownies, some blondies, things like that we bring into the market.
Okay, and Delectables, where did you come up with that name?
Since I wasn't just doing cupcakes by themselves, I wanted to kind of just be able to do a variety of items, so I chose Delectables.
Okay, well, it speaks very well for your products because they certainly are delectable.
Thank you.
Yeah, and okay, so you talked about brownies and you talked about cupcakes. Where do you get your ideas for your cupcakes, which we see a few of your samples here on the table, and I'll let you talk about each one of those a little bit more, but do you create your recipes, or do you find recipes, are they handed down from family members? Just tell us a little bit more about that.
As for recipes, I find a lot of recipes, and usually what I do is I tweak them and kind of add ingredients, just kind of change the recipes that I find to kind of make them my own.
Okay, very good. I know last week at the market you had one that you called a Cinco de Mayo, and I probably said that wrong. But
no, you said it correctly.
Okay. And I think you brought that in, and tell us a little bit about that particular cupcake.
Okay, the Cinco de Mayo is actually a lime cake, and the icing is infused with tequila and lime flavors. And I also have a little umbrella that we put in the top to decorate
okay,
it.
Okay, so you have an example of that one right
here. I have an example right here of the Cinco de Mayo. Let's loosen this up a little bit.
Okay. And as you were opening that, all of your cupcakes are, you bring them to market, and they are presented to the customers in that very clever little plastic container. Keep them fresh.
Thank you, yes.
Okay.
Yeah, this is the Cinco de Mayo cupcake.
Okay, and it has lime, you said lime juice in it?
Yeah, there's a lime juice, and there's a little bit of tequila just for flavor.
Okay, all right. Okay, well, tell us a little bit more about your other cupcakes that you have here.
This one here, this is actually a vanilla.
Oh, that's very pretty.
And it's a sugar flower, it's actually an edible flower that's on top of the cupcake.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a vanilla icing on top of vanilla cake.
Okay. And I had that last week, and actually ate that with some of Glenn Hoover's fresh strawberries, and it was just a perfect shortcake.
Oh, that's a great idea.
With a little bit more probably sweetness to it with that icing, but it was not overly sweet. That's the thing I really enjoy about your icing. It's just the right sweetness and texture.
So. I'm glad you enjoyed it.
Yeah. Now tell us a little bit about the one in the middle.
Okay, this one here is a peanut butter. There's actually a Reese's peanut butter cup on top. And it's peanut butter icing, and it's on top of chocolate cake.
Well, I'll tell you what, I think that's everybody's favorite, chocolate cake with peanut butter icing. And
this is probably the best seller, I believe, that I have out there right now.
Okay. Well, they are just wonderful cupcakes, and I, as I said, I enjoyed them. I probably ate more than I should, but you know.
I did enjoy them.
Yeah, they were just great. And the one thing I noticed, you also have sugar-free.
I do.
And explain a little bit more about that.
When I first started making the cupcakes, a lot of requests for sugar-free for people who were diabetic and had some health issues. So I began doing some sugar-free recipes
okay.
to accommodate them also.
Now, at the market, do you sell those for the same price that people can choose the sugar-free or the regular?
I do.
Okay. And when you are purchasing, we're seeing them in individual packets, but you also will sell them in larger quantities.
Yes, I will have, there's a 4-pack I have, and there's also a 6-pack they can purchase.
Okay.
The 6 cupcakes and 4 cupcakes.
Okay, we talked a little bit about an idea about recycling those plastic containers.
Yes.
Are you thinking about doing that?
I am, yeah, I'm thinking if someone brings back their container, we can actually discount the cupcakes 25 cents.
Okay, so if they bring back their plastic container and they're refilling it with a cupcake for themselves, for their own consumption,
yes.
you'll credit them 25 cents for that.
Yes.
That purchase. Well, that's great. That's a good way to recycle it, and those things are pretty sturdy, and I know, having gotten the ones from you last week at the market, that they are very sturdy, and will you can open them up and close them up, and it
they're
keeps
pretty,
everything
they're pretty
fresh.
Resilient.
Yeah, I had the one cupcake for a couple of days in there, and when I opened it up, it was as fresh as when I ate one at the market.
So
it was very good.
Great.
Very good.
I'm glad to hear that.
Now, tell us a little bit about the jar that you have here that looks like a regular canning jar, but it has something in it that's certainly not preserves.
Yeah, it's actually 2 cupcakes with layers of frosting. I can actually open this jar up.
Okay.
Okay, inside is actually, there's 2 cupcakes layered with layers of frosting.
Okay.
And each one's packaged with a fork. So you can either eat at the market or take it home.
And very decorative. You're using the hot pink theme
yes.
for your market, so people will know that it's yours just because they'll see something in hot pink. And you might want to show the camera and hold your jar with the label so that everyone can see. Do you create those on your computer? Or?
Actually, a friend of mine creates them for me.
Okay.
She's a graphic designer.
All right. Okay. Well, it certainly, speaks for what you're selling, and that's a great idea to have that cupcake right on top.
And
there.
Actually, on my label is actually, there's my website, and also the phone number to contact me to place orders.
Okay, and what is your website for those who might not be able to read it?
It's www.pamelasdelectables.com.
Okay, so they can go in and check out things online as
well. And there's photos of cupcakes, cakes that I've made.
Mm-hmm. Well, speaking of that, not only do you make the cupcakes, but you also do decorated cakes, correct?
I do.
And those are for all occasions, weddings, as well as anniversaries, special birthdays. So why don't we take a look at some of those pictures that you gave us, and you can talk a little bit about that once they pull the photographs up on the screen.
Okay, sounds great. Okay, that's actually a birthday cake.
And what's on top of it?
It's a basketball. It's a 3D basketball on top of the cake.
And is that something that's edible, or?
Yes. Yep, the basketball's edible. The t-shirt there is actually made out of a gum paste, a sugar. So that's edible as well.
And what did you use to make the basketball?
It's actually cake that's covered in fondant.
Okay. Very clever.
Okay, that's a two-tier that's covered in fondant as well. It has some decorations on top. There's a car on top. There are some sugar flowers throughout the cake.
Now, the car is not edible.
The car is not edible.
Okay. And now, explain fondant.
Fondant, it's similar to dough, but it's made out of sugar. And that can be rolled out similar to how dough is rolled out.
Okay. And is it easy to slice through?
It is, yes.
Okay.
Okay, that was a birthday cake as well. That has a cosmetic bag on top. There's some makeup, there's nail polish, and everything on the cake is actually edible, except for the ribbon at the bottom and on top of the purse on top.
I was going to say where all the bling is, right?
Yes,
not edible.
That part is not edible.
Okay.
Okay, that was for our first communion. The flowers are edible. The bling is not edible. And that's covered in fondant as well.
Now, how do you make the fondant?
Usually, I haven't really made it myself. I purchased the fondant to use.
Okay.
Now, that cake there, actually, the shoe is actually made out of gum paste. It's sugar. Mm. The cosmetics on there are sugar as well, and that's covered in fondant. And the bling is not edible, of course.
Right. So that's not a Cinderella slipper that will use glass. It's sugar.
Yes, it's actually edible.
Okay.
That was a wedding cake that I created. That's covered in fondant. It has their topper on top of it, and that was the theme of their wedding.
Mm-hmm. Now, what flavors would you put inside of a cake like that?
That was actually, I believe, chocolate and cookie dough was their choice.
Cookie dough?
It's a cookie dough filling frosting type.
Okay. I've not heard of that. So usually it's white or chocolate. So
yeah, something different.
Yeah.
That was another wedding cake.
I love the topper on that. Is that something you found? Or?
That was the bride's topper. It's very cute.
Yeah, where the groom is trying to take off.
Yes.
Very.
And
cool.
Actually, those flowers are edible as well. They're sugar flowers.
Now, how many people would a cake like that serve?
I would say between 50 and 100.
Really? Okay. And range of prices, do you have any?
Pricing for a three-tier cake, it would start between $175 and $200.
Okay.
For three tiers.
All right. And how much advance time do you need for, let's say, someone came to Penn Street Market and knew they needed a cake for a special occasion, wedding or birthday or anniversary? How much time do you need in advance?
For large order, I guess a month would be ideal, but maybe at least 3 weeks mm-hmm. of a notice.
Okay. And when we're at market, will you have, that people can actually place an order and
yes.
examples in a notebook? Or?
Yes.
Okay.
I have actually an album that has some photos of cakes I've made.
Okay.
And I'll probably bring some maybe 6-inch cakes they can see.
Okay.
Some samples.
And if they have a particular theme, as you mentioned, that one couple had, that you try and work with them to create a cake that's memorable.
I do. I try to match their colors and their theme.
Okay, that's great. And again, this is something that you're not necessarily going to have a big cake at market that people can just walk away with, but you'll have the smaller cakes that they can try. And
like a smaller, like maybe an individual cake, mm-hmm. like smaller size cakes.
Okay. Along with the cakes, then, you know, we're talking about the fact that you do baking and at a certified kitchen.
Yes.
What other items might be in the future for Pamela's Delectables? Have you given that any thought? You talked about brownies and other things that you currently do, but you know, some people might say, you know, can you bake breads? Sometimes people who are bakers do tend to specialize.
Yeah, right now I specialize in the cupcakes and cakes. Maybe eventually I'll kind of venture out to try some new things. But right now, it's the cupcakes and cakes.
Well, and I'm sure you're pretty busy because along with doing this baking, you're also a teacher.
I am, yes.
Okay, tell the viewers a little bit about where you teach and what you teach.
I teach special ed science. I teach 6th and 7th grade at Northeast and Southern Middle School in Reading.
Okay, well, that certainly takes a lot of your time, but it's great having the summers where you can be at the market and working with us to try and encourage people to come out and get some things from local producers. I can't call you a farmer. We might adopt you as a farmer. Aww. But it's great to have you, you know, joining us at the Penn Street Market and sharing your talents in baking. And I just love the presentation of these two cupcakes in here, and if you want to share with the viewers, while your pricing may change, I'm sure, you know, during different times, but you know, a price range, they can come in and get cupcakes starting at $2, I believe.
Yes, the cupcakes are $2 a piece. There is some package. The larger the quantity, the price does go down for some packages and item, and the jars are $5 each.
Okay, so you get a jar to take home and recycle and use either for your own canning or as a cup to drink out of. You know, they're very useful, and I've seen some people actually take them and make all sorts of things out of them, you know,
some
crafty
craft items.
Right, very good. Well, at this point, you know, I just want to remind everyone that at the Penn Street Market, along with Pamela's Delectables, we also have the Perk Up Truck, which is Michelle Laura's beverage truck, where she sells wonderful smoothies made out of yogurt from a local dairy farm and flavored with local berries and anything that she can find at the market, including spinach sometimes. So it could be something very healthy that helps young people especially get the vegetables that they might not otherwise eat. So smoothies are a great way to get nutritious food into not just young people, but older people as well. And then we also have Sarah Ann Stewart, who comes to the market and sells jewelry. And we are always looking for farmer vendors as well as craftspeople to come in. And actually starting on June the 21st, we will have a mother-daughter duo who will be starting at the Penn Street Market. And they are starting out as farmers. The young woman, Catherine, was actually the Ag Day baby back in the 80s. So she and her mother are going to be starting out with a small farm and raising wonderful vegetables, and so we're looking forward to having them with us at the Penn Street Market. What you need to be a farmer vendor at the market is a business privilege license and also to be a member of Berks Ag Resource Network, and actually that applies for any vendor, the business privilege license with the City of Reading. And of course, any health codes, requirements, licenses that you need to produce whatever you're producing, like baking licenses with the state, etc. So again, we're looking forward to another great season of the Penn Street Market. And if you have any questions about the market, feel free to give me a call at 610-898-5482. And after the short break, we're going to show you the video on cheese making that was created by students at Berks Career and Technology Center.
You're watching Food and Farms, Berks County Style on bctv.org. Be informed, be involved, be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For other stories and information, go to bctv.org.
Hi, and welcome back to Food and Farms, Berks County Style. We are going to have a short video that was created by the Berks Career and Technology students. And they went to a local cheesemaker, Debbie Bass, and Debbie's Cheese Board, which is located in Stauffsburg, Marion Township. And with the direction of their instructor, Jim Del Conte, they created the video that you're going to be seeing, which explains how this cheesemaker, entrepreneur, creates cheese from local dairy farms' milk, whether it's cow's, goat's, or sheep milk. So I hope you enjoy the video.
Been working with cheese since 2002, so a little over 11 years right now. And I was never trained officially as a cheesemaker. I worked with the physically and mentally handicapped almost all of my life, and I had something happen in my family where I needed to be at home. And so when I got home, I thought, well, what am I going to do? And I thought, well, cheese is something I've been interested in. And I started getting textbooks and reading and practicing. And eventually I had the state come out and help me with my regulations so that I could be permitted to have a raw milk permit to make cheese. I make both raw milk cheeses. That would be an aged cheese like cheddar or Monterey Jack. Aged cheese is made with raw milk. And it's usually done in a vat, a large vat. It has to be aged for 60 days after it's made before it can be given to the farmer or sold to the general public. And it needs to be aged 60 days because during that time cycle, the E. coli will die. And that way we know that we have a safe product to sell. As a general rule, when you're making an aged cheese, like a cheddar or a Monterey Jack, you would get about 0.9 pounds out of every gallon of milk. And I also make fresh products, fresh cheeses like fresh mozzarella, cream cheese, cottage cheese. Fresh cheeses are pasteurized, and I pasteurize my milk at 145 degrees, which is a low temperature, for 30 minutes. And that cooking process will also kill the E. coli in the fresh cheese, so that when I'm finished with the cheese that day, it can be sold that day. I do make goat cheese. Cheese made from goats is a little bit different flavor. It has a little bit of a tangy flavor that is missing in the cow's milk, and it's a really interesting flavor to develop in the cheese. So while the majority of what I do is cow milk, I do some of the goat milk cheese also. My favorite cheese to make is mozzarella, because it's a really interesting cheese that's very challenging to make, because you have to be pinpoint on the pH levels, and that's very difficult to learn how to do. But once you get the curd made, then you get to stretch it almost just like it's taffy, and you can also put it into a mold, or you can put it into water to give it a little bit more of an authentic look. Whey is the liquid product that's released from the curd as the curd is cooking. And if you look at processed foods contents list, you will always see that there's dehydrated whey listed as one of the contents, because whey is a very, very good high protein food. Well, after the cheese is aged for 60 days, we would cut it down into 1/2 pound packages. That's generally what farmers want. And vacuum pack the cheese. And if you remove all of the air from the bag, then you don't have any trouble with molds growing on the cheese. So it's a very, very safe way of packaging. All of the equipment that you see here in the plant, most of it gets tested every 3 months, and I get visited every 3 months, and I have to send my product out for testing every 3 months. And all of that is done to ensure that the general population stays well after they've been eating a product. I have about 7 local farmers that bring milk to me. Each farmer will have a different kind of herd. It may be a Guernsey herd, it may be a Jersey herd, it may be a mixed herd, and that makes the milk very, very different.
My name is Beth Rice. I'm from Bad Farm in Kempton. It stands for Beth and Dave Rice. My husband and I have been milking cows for about 30 years. We have been bringing our milk to Debbie for about 4 years. We bring it to her because she has all the permits and the license to make the cheese. We have a Pennsylvania state raw milk permit, which allows us to bring the milk to her. Normally, we bring milk to Debbie every Monday. We bring about 105 gallons, and then she can make it into various kinds of cheese for us.
I am working with local farmers in this area. These are farmers that bring their milk to me. I make their cheese for them, and then they take their products and they sell them locally. So it's all about staying close to home with your products. People can purchase the cheese that I make at the farms of my farmers, or oftentimes at farmers markets, local farmers markets in this area, like the Lebanon Farmers Market, the West Reading Farmers Market, you know, any farmers market that's popping up in almost all small towns right now, you can find it there.
Well, I want to thank the Berks Career and Technology Center West and the students there and their instructor, Jim Del Conte, for assisting me in bringing to the viewers information about how cheese is made. And I also want to especially thank Debbie Bass for allowing the students and myself to come visit her plant in Stalksburg, Marion Township. Again, cheese making is an art, and a lot of our local dairy farmers are expanding their opportunities to market their milk by going to making soft cheese, aged cheese, and selling at local farmers markets. So be sure to visit a local farmers market. We invite you to come to the Penn Street Market, where not only do we have farmer vendors, but we also have wonderful music every week, as well as restaurants every week, that we have Callow Hill Cafe, as well as Mi Casa Su Casa, and Sofrito's Gastropub, and Chapman's Deli. So join us this summer at Penn Street Market.